published in the mid-14th century, the Decameron not only changed the way prose was written by elevating common vernacular speech, it also is considered the foundation of Italian prose literature. In the preface, Giovanni Boccaccio provides a brief explanation of why he wrote the Decameron, inspired by love and wanting to give something back to all of the ladies who must suffer for their love in silence. Each day, instead of 10 tales, this summary will cover selections of those tales, begins with an introduction. The first day's introduction sets up the plot of the Decameron. Florence has been hit hard by the Black Death, or plague, a highly contagious disease spreading through cities and towns. 7 women friends meet up, and the eldest, Pampanea, suggests a plan to escape the city for the relative safety of the countryside. Philomena and Elise want some men to accompany them on the trip. 3 handsome young men arrive. The group decides to head to a palazzo, a large villa with gardens on the outskirts of Florence. Pampanea suggests a way for the group to pass the time while they are there. Over the course of the next 2 weeks they're staying at the palazzo, each member will be king or queen for a day, directing the entertainment, the food, and all aspects of the group's lives, and will choose a theme for the stories. 10 stories a day over the course of 10 days. Pampanea, queen in first day, chooses an open theme where the stories can be about anything. The stories include an evil man named Chaparello on his deathbed. He calls for a holy man and gives a false confession to a friar, who then preaches of his goodness. After his death, he's considered a saint. Gianotto tries to convince his Jewish friend Abraham to convert to Christianity. Abraham goes to Rome to observe the holiness of the clergy, only to find them corrupt. He returns to Gianotto and becomes a Christian despite this. In another story, Saladin lays a trap for Melchizedek to get the money he needs. Melchizedek avoids the trap by telling a story about 3 rings. Saladin, impressed by his answer, rewards him. A monk enjoys the sexual company of a young lady. Using his wits, the monk tempts the abbot. He avoids punishment by discovering the abbot also had sex with the young lady. Philomena, queen in second day, chooses tales in which the characters overcome misfortunes to attain happiness for her daily theme. Here, the symbol of fortune, or the wheel of fortune, is prominent. In the Decameron, fortune is random and unpredictable. People are raised in status or wealth, then brought to a lower position in status by another turn of the wheel. The second day of stories all revolve around misadventures with happy endings. The Wheel of Fortune is a symbol of the up and down cycle. In some cases, it has a physical representation as well. Among this day's stories, Andreuccio journeys to Naples to buy horses, but instead gets caught up in several unfortunate adventures. He loses the money, but leaves town after many adventures with a ring. Alatiel, the daughter of the Sultan of Babylon, is sent overseas to marry the King of Algarve. After many misadventures and numerous relations with a number of men, she finally returns to her father. Convinced she's still a virgin, Alatiel's father sends her once again to the King of Algarve. Nefile, queen in third day, suggests they skip both Friday and Saturday, days of religious observation, and reconvene on Sunday. Nefile also changes the venue, moving the group to a different palace with a magnificent garden. Gardens and the growth linked to them is another key symbol in the Decameron. The gardens represent a kind of safety. In medieval literature, a walled garden was used to keep something safe or allow for privacy. Because of the way religion permeated almost all aspects of medieval life, one can also view the garden as a return to Eden, the biblical garden of Adam and Eve. The storytellers escape the threat of infection, the filth of dead bodies left in the streets, and the stress of a world turned upside down. The garden is an idyllic space, beautiful and peaceful. Pampanea even forbids news of the outside world while they are away, making it a true respite away from the fallen world of man. Back to the story. Nefile requests stories that showcase ingenuity. In one, Masetto pretends to be a deaf mute to get a job as a gardener at a convent. He enjoys sexual favors from all the nuns there. After becoming exhausted by all the sex, he pretends he's been healed and becomes a steward of the convent. In another story, a young woman named Alibek seeks out a monk named Rustico, who teaches her how to put the devil back in hell, a joking reference to sexual relations. When he can no longer match her stamina, he gives her away to be married. Filostrato, king in fourth day, is interrupted by Boccaccio himself, who tells a story of his own in response to his critics who claim he cares too much for women and their entertainment. Once he has addressed his detractors with a well-known story about men, the reader is returned to the narrative, and Filostrato chooses stories of love that end unhappily for his theme. One man tries to keep his widowed daughter all to himself. When he discovers she has taken a lover, he orders the man killed and has his heart delivered to her in a goblet. She kills herself with poison. In another story, Brother Alberto convinces a vain woman the angel Gabriel is in love with her so he can enjoy her sexual favors. When his ruse is discovered, he attempts to hide, only to be rescued by his fellow brothers and dies in the monastery. And in another story, Isabetta's beloved is killed by her brothers. She finds his head and plants it with some basil herbs and waters it with her tears. Her brothers take the plant from her and find her lover's head. They flee and Isabetta dies. Fiametta, queen in Fifth Day, chooses as her theme stories about lovers who overcome misfortune. A man finds a young man sleeping with his daughter. He makes the two marry, and they all live happily together. Another man loves a woman who does not return his love, and he spends all his money attempting to impress her. When she visits him to save her son, he feeds her his treasured falcon. Her son dies, but she marries this falconer. Elisa, queen in Sixth Day, decides the theme shall be stories about people using their wit to overcome hardship. In one story, two intelligent men travel together. They're caught in a rainstorm and continue their journey, insulting each other's ugly appearances. In another story, Brother Cipolla claims to have in his possession a feather from the angel Gabriel's wing. Two young men take it as a joke. Cipolla discovers he no longer has the feather and makes up an amazing lie. Elisa then takes the women to the Valley of the Ladies, a beautiful spot filled with various fruit trees and a lake. Dioneo, king in Seventh Day, calls for stories in which wives fool their husbands. In one story, a woman entertains her lover while her husband is gone, but when he returns early, she hides her lover in a barrel. Her lover pretends to have purchased the barrel, but not before the husband cleans it while he continues his relations with the very willing wife. Dioneo tells the story of two friends who make a pact. Whoever dies first will come back and tell the other whatever they want to know. Both fall in love with the same woman, and the friend who sleeps with the lady is the first to die. He appears to the living friend and admits that among the sins he's working off in purgatory, having slept with the woman is a minor one. The living friend is happy to hear that. Loretta follows Filomena's example and asks they skip both Friday and Saturday and resume their storytelling on Sunday. Then the group tells stories where people trick others, not just wives tricking their husbands. In one story, a fool and his two friends go to a river to gather rocks that allegedly render the bearer invisible. Calandrino fills his pockets with rocks, thinking they're magic, when it's really just his two friends playing a trick on him. Loretta crowns Emilia queen in Ninth Day. Emilia decides the theme is to tell whatever stories the group wishes. In one, a young nun manages to evade punishment for sleeping with her lover by catching the abbess accidentally wearing a pair of pants on her head instead of a wimple. The nun gets away with having her lover visit her. In another story, a priest stays with his friend. He tells this friend and his wife he can show them how to turn a woman into a mare and back again. The priest instead uses this opportunity to try to have sex with his friend's wife. Amelia crowns Panfilo king in Tenth Day, telling him it's his responsibility to make up for all the previous monarch's shortcomings. He asks for stories where people have acted generously for love. In one story, Griselda is the patient and obedient wife of Gualtieri. He puts her through many cruel trials to test her, passes each one, and eventually they live happily ever after. At the end of his day, Panfilo reminds the group they've been away from Florence for 15 days, and it's time for their journey to end. In his author's conclusion, Boccaccio addresses some of the criticism he expects to receive. He counters the bawdy, lewd nature of the tales not being fit for women, then goes on to deal with those who have a problem with coarse language. He argues the tales are neither good or bad. It is the listener, or reader, and their frame of mind that will make them so. A sword is not good or bad. It is the hand that wields it that makes the decisions behind the actions. He ends hoping the women reading his stories have enjoyed them and think fondly of him. Readers will note that love, class, religion, and trickery and wit are the Decameron's main themes. Most of the stories within the Decameron deal with some form of love or lust. True love is deep and lasting, while lust is fleeting. Boccaccio's women have as much agency as the men and enjoy sex as much as men do, A stark departure from the literature of the time period, in which women were characterized as ideally chaste and pure. Boccaccio wrote during a period of immense change as the medieval period gave way to the Renaissance. The feudal society of the Middle Ages was moving toward a system based on commerce, where traders and merchants began to hold sway. The plague upended social order, which led, eventually, to the rise of the middle class. The Decameron is a melding of the old guard and the new order, the medieval and almost out-of-touch behavior of the storytellers juxtaposed with the rising sensibilities of the Renaissance. Religion in medieval Europe was widespread. Catholicism was the order of the day, and the Pope ruled in Rome. Although the plague may have upset the course of daily life, the church and religious services went on as best they could. Although many would happily mock the corrupt clergy at any time, most people still believed in God and still worshiped at their church. However, Boccaccio's focus on the love between men and women, rather than love for God, abbots, friars, and monks, are no different in the Decameron than other men. They are subject to the same lusts and greed. Trickery and wit play important parts in nearly all the stories in the Decameron. It's present in practically all of the stories, either through pranks, disguises, lies, magic, and misdirection. People use costumes to appear wealthy for the purpose of obtaining money or sex. New identities are often created and discarded like clothing. Boccaccio shows these to be impressive and desirable traits, even when he plays them for laughs. Unfathomably trailblazing and influential, the Decameron continues to be entertaining over half a millennia after its publication.